Hey friends, today we will discuss about how to approach a neonate with pallor or anemia. This is not only an important question for MD, DCH, DNB exams, but this is also something that we see in our NICU on a day-to-day practice. So if such a question is asked in your exams, always start with the definition. Definition of a neonate, as you know, is 0 to 28 days of life. What is anemia in a neonate? Anemia in a neonate more than 34 weeks is a central venous hemoglobin of less than 13 grams per deciliter. But if you are doing it through a capillary hemoglobin, it should be less than 14.5 gram per deciliter. This is when you call it as an anemia. When you want to define microcytosis in a neonate, MCV of less than 95 femtoliters is called as microcytosis, whereas hypochromia is 34 picograms. What is the normal physiology and how does your hemoglobin change after the baby is born? I'll just touch upon the important points. What do you expect the normal hemoglobin of a neonate to be? It can be anywhere between 14 to 20 grams per deciliter with a reticulocyte count of 3 to 7%. As with adults, erythropoietin plays a role, but the role is slightly different or modified. See what happens in utero, the baby is in a relatively hypoxic saturation of 45%. So what happens, the erythropoietin concentration is very high to increase the RBC and hemoglobin synthesis. After the baby is born, you know that the baby's saturation increases to 90-95% by 5 to 10 minutes of birth. So what happens, the erythropoietin realizes that I have no work here. The baby's saturations are good and I don't have to produce any more RBCs or hemoglobin. So it shuts down. So when the erythropoietin shuts down, what happens? The existing RBCs continue to thrive and function. And once the lifespan of those RBCs come down, slowly the hemoglobin starts dropping. But remember, even though the hemoglobin drops, this is not a functional anemia. What I mean by that is, even though hemoglobin is dropping, the oxygen delivery to the tissue remains unaffected. After all, that is what we are looking at, or that is what the function of hemoglobin is, correct? You define anemia by stating that whenever the tissue oxygenation is affected, you call it as an anemia. So here, despite hemoglobin dropping, how does the tissue delivery remain same? See, the baby or a neonate in utero has very high concentration of hemoglobin F. This hemoglobin F holds on to oxygen very strongly. So even though the affinity to oxygen is very high, it does not release the oxygen to tissues where it is needed. But after birth, the hemoglobin A concentration starts increasing, and so does 2,3-DPG, diphosphoglycerin. This increases the hemoglobin to release oxygen to the tissues. And hemoglobin A per se has lesser affinity to oxygen compared to that of hemoglobin F. These two reasons together make sure the end point, which is the tissues, receive enough oxygen. So there is no functional anemia per se, even though you record anemia in your CBCs. This drop in hemoglobin continues till around, say, 3 months in a term baby. It reaches to a minimum of 11 gram per deciliter, at which point your erythropoietin wakes up, saying, okay, I will increase now so that the hemoglobin can increase once again. Whereas in preterm babies, this lowest point is reached earlier and the lowest point is lesser compared to that of term babies. What are the causes of anemia? Remember 3H, hypoplastic, hemolytic, hemorrhagic. Hypoplastic, where the hemoglobin or the RBC is not produced at all. Second, the hemoglobin is produced, RBC is produced, but it is getting destroyed. Third, it is produced, it is not destroyed, but it is lost somewhere. This is what we are going to see. Hypoplastic anemia, where RBC is not produced from bone marrow. It may not be produced due to congenital genetic disorders like Diamond-Blackfan syndrome, iron transport defects like atransferemia, or it can be due to acquired causes causing bone marrow suppression like a sepsis. Next, hemorrhagic anemia. Hemorrhagic anemia can happen in utero, during birth, or after birth. Let us see what happens before birth. Antepartum. Antepartum hemorrhage can happen at the placental level, it can happen at the cord level, or it can happen at the fetal level. Placental level, you know, abruptio placenta. Abruptio placenta, always remember to ask history if there was a retroplacental clot, because not always the mother will present with a hemorrhage. Sometimes after delivery of placenta, a huge retroplacental clot may be removed and the mother may not be aware. So always check the delivery notes and discuss with the obstetrician who delivered the baby. Next, cord anomalies, where there is abnormal insertion of cord or abnormal separation of cord, etc. Next, fetus. Whenever there is a twin-twin transfusion syndrome, in that situation what happens? The donor twin loses blood to the recipient twin. This happens in monochorionic pregnancies. Remember, try not to put a diagnosis of TTTS in a dichorionic diamniotic twin. Next, intrapartum cause. Intrapartum fetometanal hemorrhage. See, fetometanal hemorrhage, traditionally the cutoff has been around 30 ml. At this cutoff, the incidence will be around 3 per 1000 live births. Okay. And to identify this, again we need to have a suspicion and do a Clehure-Betke test, which I will be discussing later. Next, at the neonatal, after the baby is born, how can a hemorrhage happen? The hemorrhage can be inside the baby or it can be outside, meaning visible to the eyes and invisible to the eyes. Invisible is more common. Okay. Birth traumas like cephalhematomas, there can be subgaleal bleeds. Subgaleal bleed is very, very notorious because, see, this rupture of emissary veins is what will cause your subgaleal bleed. And what happens? The blood continues to accumulate in the epicranial aponeurosis. There is nothing stopping the accumulation because the area is so huge. It extends anywhere from your orbital margin and back to your nuchal ridge and laterally to both temporal fascias. So in this huge area, when the blood accumulates, as much as 260 ml of blood can accumulate in this area. So if you continue to measure the head circumference of the neonate, and if 1 centimeter of increase is noted, it means approximately 40 ml of blood is getting accumulated. So 40 ml per every 1 centimeter increase in head circumference is what will constitute a subgaleal bleed's volume. Okay. There can be an intracranial hemorrhage, of course, intraparenchymal, it can be a subarachnoid bleed, it can be a epidural bleed, subdural bleed, etc. Open obvious bleeding that you can see is mostly due to DIC is what we note. Next, iatrogenic bleed. Iatrogenic bleed, in the sense you continuously sample the babies for multitude of investigations. So what happens if you are not using a micro sampling technique and every time you prick the baby for blood, 1 ml, 2 ml, 1 ml, 2 ml, it may not be much for a huge volume containing people like adults or even older children. But when a neonate and that too a smaller preterm baby, if you continuously sample blood, then the loss is huge for the baby. So always try to do restricted sampling and micro sampling techniques. I'm sorry, this does not come here. Next, the blood is produced. The blood is not lost somewhere, but it is being destroyed. So how all the RBCs can be destroyed? There can be a problem with the RBC itself per se, or something else is causing the destruction of RBCs. So what is this something else? This is immune hemolysis and non-immune hemolysis. Immune hemolysis is your ABO incompatibility between the mother and the baby and RH incompatibility between mother and the baby. Non-immune hemolysis is secondary to sepsis or in utero transmissible infections like your TORCH. What are intrinsic RBC defects? The RBC defect can be on the membrane like spherocytosis. It can be in the enzymes like G6PD or pyruvate kinase. It can be an hemoglobinopathy. Hemoglobinopathy, always remember, it is not beta thalassemia. Beta thalassemia starts manifesting only after 4 to 6 months of age. Okay. The unstable hemoglobins like alpha thalassemia will present in neonatal period. Nutritional deficiency, vitamin E is specifically in preterms. So now you know the causes. And what are the investigations you are going to do to identify what is causing anemia in this neonate? The most important investigations that you need to do are to get a hemoglobin, a reticulocyte count, bilirubin, and a direct Coombs test apart from your peripheral smear. Okay, basic tests. If you have these tests, at least you can classify and narrow down the possible differential diagnosis for a baby having anemia. Hemoglobin obviously will be decreased in everything. That is why you are calling it as an anemia. So forget that. Next, reticulocytes. If reticulocyte count is decreased, it means the bone marrow is not giving an appropriate response to the reduced RBC count. Means bone marrow is not functioning. So this is some form of hypoplastic anemia. We don't know what it is, but at least you know it is a hypoplastic anemia, and you will work up accordingly. You will do a bone marrow if needed. You will do iron indices if needed, etc. Next, rest every other condition, your reticulocyte will increase. Okay. We will see the exceptions as we go one by one. If the reticulocyte count is increased, you know bone marrow is functioning properly. Next, you will come to bilirubin. If the bilirubin is increased, what it means? It means that there is some form of hemolysis happening. And if the DCT is positive in that case, you put it as an immune hemolytic anemia. If it is negative, you put it as a non-immune hemolytic anemia. Hemolytic, why? Because bilirubin is increased. Correct? Next, bilirubin is normal, your DCT is negative, your reticulocyte count is increased or normal. Why I am telling as increased or normal is, say if the baby is having an acute hemorrhage, meaning the baby has had a subgaleal bleed immediately after birth. Do you expect the baby to have an increased reticulocyte count? No, because it will take some time for the bone marrow to start producing reticulocyte counts. So in that the case, hemoglobin will be very much reduced, your bilirubin level will be normal, DCT will be negative obviously, and reticulocyte count will still be normal. But this baby has a hemorrhagic anemia. If the baby has had a chronic hemorrhagic anemia, then the reticulocyte count will be increased and the bilirubin level may be marginally elevated because the bone marrow has had time to produce some amount of reticulocyte. Other investigations are your blood grouping, RS typing, cross matching. You want to know if there is incompatibility. Next, Kleher-Bethke test. This is how I pronounce, guys. So this is for fetal-maternal hemorrhage. So this is based on the principle of acid elution, meaning the hemoglobin F is resistant to elution by acid, whereas the hemoglobin A in the mother, the hemoglobin loses itself, we will put it that way, loses its characteristics with acid. So when you are staining with eosin, what happens? There is almost no hemoglobin to stain. So it appears as ghost cells, whereas the hemoglobin F appears pink. Clear on this? This is acid elution test or Kleher-Bethke test. But what is the clinical caveat in this? Imagine a mother who has a raised hemoglobin F. So in that case, what is going to happen? This test is abnormally going to tell that this mother has had some sort of fetal-maternal hemorrhage, or the baby born to this mother has had a hemorrhage. So to overcome that, you can do an immunofluorescence flow cytometry, where specific antigens present only in the fetus or fetal RBCs are looked for. So in that situation, you overcome this clinical conundrum. You can evaluate for TORCH if you are suspecting. DIC workup can be done if you are suspecting the baby with a sepsis. This is another flow chart that you can follow in your clinical setup. Anemia with reticulocyte count decreased is hypoplastic anemia because bone marrow is not mounting a response. If the reticulocyte count is normal or increased and you do a Coombs test, if it is positive, it is isoimmune. Remember, Coombs negative also can be immune hemolysis. Not many of them will have a Coombs positivity. In a peripheral smear, you are finding microcytic hypochromic anemia. There is some sort of hemorrhage that has happened. Membrane defects, you will obviously note. If it is a normochromic normocytic anemia without jaundice, then there is an acute blood loss of some kind. If there is jaundice, there is some sort of hemolysis that is happening. It can be due to intrinsic RBC defects or something is destroying the RBCs like a sepsis. How do you treat these babies? Now you have arrived at whatever may be the cause of anemia, but this baby needs treatment, and the baseline treatment usually is a PRBC transfusion. So you know to give a PRBC, but how do you give a PRBC and what are the things you need to make sure before giving a PRBC? Packed red blood cells. Ideally, it should be from the same donor. Multiple aliquots has to be arranged so that multiple donors are not used for the same baby. Next, fresh RBCs. See, fresh RBCs are preferred because the 2,3 diphosphoglycerate concentration will be more, meaning the oxygen delivery to the tissue will be more. Plus, if you take a donor sample which is fresh, the same donor sample can be used for a prolonged time for the same baby. You are getting the idea, right? A PRBC can be stored for 42 days. Suppose you are taking a donor at 32nd day. Next 10 days will be the time where you will be able to use the donor's RBC. After that, you will have to switch over to somebody else. But if the same donor RBC is used at say day 2 or 3, you have the next 2 to 3 weeks. And the same donor can be used multiple times for this same baby. But having said that, using fresher RBC does not reduce the number of transfusions per patient. Okay, so it does not have a clear, extra advantage. Follow whatever is being followed in your hospital setting. Next, cross match. This is another important point to note. It is not just enough if you cross match the baby sample against that of a donor RBC. You also have to sample the mother, because see, the ABO antigens can be expressed very weakly in the neonatal RBCs, but there will be maternally transferred IgG antibodies. Imagine the mother is A positive and baby is B positive. What happens? You expect the baby to have your A antibody, but imagine the mother. This mother is having A blood group. The mother will be having antibodies against B blood group, and that would have transmitted transplantally to the baby. So this baby is having IgG antibodies to B from the mother, Ig immunoglobulins to A from the baby itself. So in that case, you cannot give A or B. Both will be detrimental to the baby. Prefer a O blood group with Rh compatibility. Understood? So always cross match, and the baby's and the mother's blood should cross match properly with that of the donor RBC. How much PRBC to give and how to give? Follow a restrictive policy on transfusion and lower transfusion volumes, meaning not more than 10 to 12 ml per kg. How much will you give? Your desired PCV minus actual PCV divided by your PCV of the packed cells that is being transfused. Blood volume is blood volume of the baby. A term baby will have 80 ml per kg. Preterm baby or a late preterm baby will have 90 ml per kg. A very preterm baby can have even 100 ml per kg. Depending upon the gestational age, the blood volume of the baby varies. So, blood volume into whatever packed cell volume concentration you desire minus the present PCV in the baby divided by your donor RBC's PCV. At what rate do you give your PRBC? Now you know the volume that needs to be given. How fast to give? If the baby does not have cardiac failure, give at 5 ml per kg per hour. If the baby is in cardiac failure, give at 2 ml per kg per hour. What response do you expect after giving a transfusion? If you give a transfusion of up to 9 ml per kg, you can expect a hemoglobin increase by 3 gram per deciliter. Whom will you give? Now you have decided PRBC can be given, this much has to be given, at this rate has to be given, etc. etc. But whom do you give your PRBC? PRBC, these two indications are irrespective of gestational age. If there is a severe anemia of antenatal onset, say due to antepartum hemorrhage, or there is a severe RH isoimmunization in utero itself and the baby is coming out with cardiac failure, then you give a transfusion or a partial exchange transfusion. If there is an acute blood loss more than 10% with features of decreased oxygen delivery, or any loss greater than 20% blood volume acutely, then you give PRBC transfusion. Apart from that, in preterms and terms, the indications vary. For preterm, the first 24 hours of life, if the baby is ventilated, it is less than 12 gram per deciliter. If the baby is on non-invasive ventilation, it can be CPAP, it can be HFNC, anything. In the first 24 hours, it is 12 gram per deciliter, and in the first week after that is less than 10 gram per deciliter. If the baby is not on any supplemental oxygen, but you find a hemoglobin of less than 10 gram per deciliter, give a transfusion. In term babies, when do you give? In a severe pulmonary disease, less than 12, severe cardiac disease, less than 12, any severe cardiopulmonary disease, less than 12, moderate disease, major surgery, 2 ems, less than 10, any symptomatic anemia, less than 7. We will see what the severe, moderate, symptomatic means in the next slide. Okay, so severe cardiopulmonary disease is 12. If there is a moderate pulmonary disease, major surgery, 2 ems, 10. If there is a symptomatic anemia, it is 7. What do you mean by severe? Severe is, remember, any invasive ventilation with a MAP of more than 6 is severe. Moderate is anything that requires a FiO2 of more than 35%. Non-invasive form of ventilation is moderate pulmonary disease. Symptomatic is at full caloric intake, the weight gain is inadequate, less than 10 gram per kg per day, with a tachycardia persisting for more than 24 hours, then you consider it as symptomatic. So after you have given PRBC, are you done? No. You will still treat whatever is causing the anemia if it is a treatable cause. You will give support with iron supplementation, folic acid supplementation. Vitamin E is in preterm babies. How do you prevent this neonatal anemia from happening? Ideally, prevention should be your goal. You should try to do a delayed cord clamping to allow for placental transfusion to happen. Restricted blood sampling and micro sampling should be done. If it is a RH negative mother, give anti-D injection. Follow asepsis protocol in NICU. And vitamin K administration can be done. Thank you guys for your patient listening. I know this was a long lecture. Hope it was useful for you. If you have any more topics, please let me know in the comments below. I will try to make those videos as soon as possible. And if you like the lectures, please subscribe and give a like button. And press the bell icon next to it so that you get instant notifications whenever I post a video. Thank you guys. Bye.